It's my absolute pleasure to be in the workshop today, and I'm joined by Matt O'Dell. Hello, Matt. How are you doing?
Hi, guys.
What are we going to be up to in this video presentation?
So, guys, today we're going to look at direct online starters. Okay, this is an online starter.
Yep.
In this case, we've got a three-phase online starter set up and a single-phase direct online starter set up. And we're just going to look at how they're wired up, and we're going to go upstairs and look at the actual wiring diagrams, how it all works, and just go through that, really.
And it's really important, as we're looking with one eye on AM2S.
Yes.
We believe, and it will evolve over time, so it could change, that at the moment there is a three-phase direct online starter.
Yes.
That has to be wired up and tested. So
yep.
We're in that process of actually looking at the wiring connections in this video.
Yes.
We're going to pop upstairs. Hopefully Joe will be up there with his whiteboard, pens and calculator, and we'll disturb him, and we'll look at the wiring diagrams that go with these direct online starters.
So then, Joe, today we're looking at a direct online starter layout.
Very nice.
Come up into the classroom. We briefly saw downstairs the what a direct online starter is. I think we had the single phase and the three phase online starter. And now we're just going to look through the connections, or how to do the connections, on the whiteboard.
Fantastic. Could you maybe just tell me what these bits and bobs are, Matt? So what have we got going on up here?
Okay, so when you take the plate of an online starter off, it doesn't quite look the same as this. But this is just the basic principle of how a coil will operate the contacts.
Mm-hmm.
And so we'll go through the video. As we go along, we'll explain what bit does what. But the basic principle is that you've got a direct online starter here, represented this square, and we have a single phase motor.
Okay.
So this will just be wired up single phase.
So this is what we're going to try and get running. This is what we're going to try and connect up.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah. So what we have then, we're going to bring our line conductor in.
Mm-hmm.
And so the line conductor will come in on number one.
Mm-hmm.
And it will simply come out on number two and go directly to the motor.
Okay, so it's passing through this contact here, which is basically just a switch, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, and then it goes from there. And this part here, which is the overload for the motor.
That's the overload,
That's just kind of, that's normally hardwired into the bottom of the contactor,
that's
isn't it?
It's
pressed in, screwed in, and actually that output terminal kind of becomes
that output terminal. Yeah.
Right.
And they're quite awkward to do, actually physically put them in, but that's what this is representing there. So the three contacts there are now in line with the overload relay.
Yeah.
So the line conductor comes in and literally comes out. The neutral then becomes a bit more of a problem.
Okay.
Okay. So you could just simply bring the neutral in on number three and out on number four, and everything would be fine.
Yeah.
But the problem is there, we're missing out this contact, so that contact then doesn't do anything.
Okay.
And what's more, inside of the overload relay, where you've got your physical overload relays, they're not all being utilised.
Oh, okay.
And so it's a good idea to ensure that they are all being utilised to make sure it everything's balanced out.
Okay.
So instead of going, so we're coming on number three with our neutral, and instead of going out to number four and to the motor, we bring the neutral all the way back in on number five.
Oh, I see, right.
And then we come simply out on number six.
Oh, that's a clever little pro tip. I like that. Yeah.
So it doesn't actually matter whether you did it with the line conductor or the neutral. I just think it's better to do the neutral, and you've got less, shall we say, live wires floating around, sort of thing.
So
in
it's
the
better
box.
To take the neutral background and use that again and pass that through the contactor twice.
Yes, okay. I think so, yeah. So that way the overload relays internally are all being utilised.
Yeah, that's clever, I like that.
Okay, so that's the basic, that's basically when you put an online starter in, that is exactly what generally that's all you have to do.
Those are the connections you'll make.
Yeah, just connect, if it's single phase or three phase, however you do it, you just connect them in and connect them out, and that's it.
Smart.
The more awkward thing is when you start connecting up the start and the stop buttons and the actual coil.
Sure.
Sometimes they are already pre-wired, but in this case, we're going to go through the wiring for that.
Ah, brilliant. So we're going to put that in and we can trace it around.
Everything. So we have contacts number 13 and 14. As you can see, they look exactly the same as the other contacts.
Mm-hmm.
but they are called our retaining contacts.
Right.
And so that's our retaining contacts there, number 13 and 14. Okay. And what they do is they hold the motor, they hold the contacts in mm-hmm. when the start button has been depressed, shall
right.
we say.
So if we didn't have this going on, when we pressed the start button, the motor would turn on, and then when we took a finger off,
it would just turn off.
And if you want to leave it running, obviously, you don't have to stand with your finger on the button for the whole time.
No. So in this case then, we take a line, conductor, through to there. Just take a conductor from there mm-hmm. to there, yep. easy as that.
Cool, so that side of the contact will be permanently live effectively.
Yes, yep. Yep. Okay. This one, we then simply take one of these wires to number 17 okay. of the start.
Yeah.
Okay, now the numbers are, these numbers are always numbered 17 and 18. Mm-hmm. These numbers here are always numbered 13 and 14.
Okay.
And it's quite simple that they are, number 13 and 17 connect together, mm-hmm. and number 14
yep.
and 18 connect together.
Oh, right.
And so notice with them, they've been parallel with
each
other.
Yeah, I was just going to say, the way you've laid that out there, you can clearly see that they're connected in parallel. Yeah, I like that. That's good. Yeah.
And so that's the principal operation. And if you press the start button, mm-hmm. these contacts yep. are all in play with one another.
Right, got you.
Now, we now need to wire up the stop button, because yep. obviously once the motor's running, it needs to be able to stop. Mm-hmm. So in this case, we just simply take a line conductor down to the stop button.
Yep.
And then we come from here.
Yep.
And we come across into what I call the overload contacts.
Right, so when the overload operates, when this disconnects the supply, it actually will trip that connection out, because at the minute yep. that's showing as connected.
Yes.
So when a fault occurs, that will actually open, is that correct?
Yes, and because it's in series
yep.
with all this, that will then just break the circuit and eventually the motor will stop.
Got you.
Now, we call this usually the auxiliary circuit, mm-hmm. okay? And so these are known as auxiliary connections.
Yep.
And so we're just going to concentrate on 95 and 96. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter whether you take this to 96 or 95.
Yep.
It doesn't matter which one they go in.
Yep.
Or you just have to take it to one of them. Mm-hmm. Now, these are normally what's called a normally closed contact, okay. an NC contact,
yep.
normally closed. And you can see that from the black contacts there. And it shows that it's closed. Now, we then take another cable back, and we go into the coil.
Ah, right. So if you trace this through, then eventually it's making contact onto A1. So when this is energized, A1 yes, is yeah. connected to the supply.
Again, it doesn't matter if you went to A1 or A2.
Okay.
It's just a simple coil. Mm-hmm. It makes no difference, but it's, generally speaking, we go to
common
A1
practice.
First.
Go
common
to A1,
practice.
Yeah.
Yeah. We haven't spoken about the coil too much yet.
Okay.
So the coil in this case is a 230 volt coil.
Right.
It has to be 230 volt coil because it's a single phase installation. Mm-hmm. So it's obvious that the coil is also going to be 230 volts.
Fantastic.
Okay, then. So that's the basic setup of yep. of how you connect up the auxiliary circuit. We're missing one thing though.
I was just going to say, I don't know a lot about electrical science. Check out Joe Robinson training to see that proved. However, I don't think this coil is going to do anything, Matt, because it doesn't have a neutral connection.
No. So that's what we need to do.
Brilliant.
So remember, we came in on this side.
Yep.
And then we come through out on number 4, all the way back round to number 5,
yep.
and out on number 6. Now, one of the common mistakes that I have seen mm-hmm. is that they take this one
yep.
to be the neutral feed to go across to here.
Yep.
The problem is,
that's not connected, is it? Until the contactor pulls in, yeah. and the contactor yeah. can't pull in without being connected. So you've got yourself into a catch 22.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's when we have seen where faults, you know, when things haven't been working, that's right. often been a go-to place.
Yep.
So from the connection here, we go along, and then we come all the way just down simply to A2.
There you go, and there's the neutral connection. Yeah, very nice.
That's what we call the auxiliary circuit.
Fantastic.
And that's basically how it is wired up. So
if we trace this through then, if I press that button in,
yeah,
current's going to flow across the start button, through the stop button, which is closed,
yeah,
through the overload contact,
which again is closed,
onto the 230 volt coil. That's going to energize because we've got a neutral connection now, which is going to pull all four of these contactors in. The motor will start, and then also at the same time, those two make contact, which means we've then got a path the current can take down there through the stop button, which still has to break the circuit, through the overload and onto A1, which means then if I release that button there, the electricity is actually still flowing. It becomes almost like self-sustaining.
That's it. So just to reiterate on that, we have a permanent live connection here, and we have a permanent live connection there. And it's really important that, that's done that way.
Nice.
These ones aren't permanently live until this is pressed in, which then this all becomes live. And like you said, the flow of the current through to the coil. And then as soon as that is depressed or sort of let go, the current now flows through this contact all the way back through the circuit and keeping it all going.
Cool.
So just the principle of operation with how a coil operates. So the magnetic field is being set up, and this we call it an armature. And so the armature, when the coil is energized, the magnetic field pulls the armature across, and so I can represent that with an arrowhead, shall we say.
Nice.
That's going to go across into that direction.
Yep.
And that then brings all of these four contacts in place.
So this is perhaps a piece of soft iron or something that's that's easily magnetized and will be attracted to the magnetic field generated here. And these, although again we've shown these connected, these are mechanically connected, aren't they? Not electrically connected. No, so obviously we don't have a piece of soft iron shorting out the switches. Fantastic.
So one of the other things with a direct online start, we've said that they work for motors, electric motors. Usually it's direct online starters are often said that they're up to about 4 to 5 kilowatts.
Okay.
That's not strictly true. That's what it says in the books. It always depends on the load that you are actually driving. So for example, if you've got a grain store, when that motor driving an auger or something like that, once that's started, if it's already in the grain, it's under maximum load straight away.
Okay.
So that's where an online starter is limited to maybe 4 to 5 kilowatts.
All right.
If it's say for a water pump, when there's no resistance, when the water's not flowing, there's no resistance, then these can be actually up to about 8 or 9 kilowatts sort of thing.
Okay.
So they're not necessarily, even though it will say that in some of the books, it does depend on the load and the application that you are going
to
fit one.
And a lot of it boils down to the inrush current, doesn't
it?
And how that's managed. Because obviously with a direct online starter, there's no management of the inrush current like there would be with say a star delta starter or something like that.
So another thing that I just wanted to point out is obviously the full motor or the full load current is going through these contacts all the way through to the motor. The auxiliary side is hardly taking anything at all.
Okay.
And that's the beauty with the auxiliary side. This can all be done in small, and generally it's done in small wiring. So this one could be, I don't know, it could be wired up in 6 mil. This one only needs to be wired up in sort of 1 mil sort of thing.
Right.
So because it's taking no current flow. So you could be reading 10 amps coming in, but only, milliamps on the actual auxiliary side.
Clever stuff.
One thing that I want to point out is what this thing is here. Do you know what this is?
So I'm going to say that is a very inaccurate clock.
Okay, could say that. What it is... So we've got here the overload relay, okay? Now the relays are completely settable, okay? So in this case, we've got 1 to 6 amps, and it's reading, you'll see a little arrow on here, so that's reading just between 5 and 6 amps at the moment.
Okay.
So I think on the AM2S, you have to set an overload relay, and so you will have a predetermined setting, and so, I don't know, it might be 5 amps. So then you physically have to get your screwdriver in. Usually it's a little slotted dial in there.
Right.
You put your screwdriver in and you just set it, and it then has to be lined up with this arrow.
Okay, fantastic.
And that's how
that information, they might have to calculate it. It may be found in the specification manual. That could be in a number of different places.
So on the motor, there's often a plate on the motor, and it will say what the setting is.
Yep.
One of the ways that you do it maybe in industry is you get the motor running for what it's being used for. So if it's for a grain store or something, you actually get it working.
Yeah.
Then you physically measure it with a clamp on ammeter
and see what it's
and then you set it to that.
Right.
Because as you know, the current that's on there might not be
yeah.
what it's actually using yeah. when it's actually under load.
Under load, yeah, that makes sense. Good stuff.
Okay, so I think that's the basic setting of a direct online starter.
Fantastic. So now we can go on and have a look at some variants on this theme.
Yes, okay. Yeah.
Now that's really interesting, Matt, where you've got a direct online starter by itself controlling a motor, but I'm interested to know what happens when we start thinking about adding some remote stop starts in. But I think that might be the subject of a future video. We'll
yeah.
return to that.
Yeah,
so we'll should we end this one?
Yeah.
We'll okay. do it Gary style. Yeah?
Okay.
Okay, let's do it GSH style. Yeah. We hope this video has been some help.